Okay, welcome. Look at this crowd. I'm supposed to introduce Dan Buettner here, and I don't think I need to. Like, look at all these people here to see this presentation. I think you know who Dan Buettner is. Founder of Blue Zones Kitchen, which is exhibiting here, and very interesting guy. The TV show, the Netflix TV show, all sorts of good stuff coming out of Dan. Really, I don't know, who was here for the last session on health span? Good, a nice number of people. These dovetail nicely. We learned a lot about health span, and with Dan, we get to learn a lot about the impacts of nutrition on our lifespan, our health span, how long we get to live on this planet and be happy about doing so. But it's more than just nutrition, it's lifestyle, and that's what the Blue Zones are all about. So we're gonna bring Dan up in a minute, but we're gonna familiarize you or re-familiarize you with the Netflix television show first. So let's take a look at that right now.
What's the best tea to drink on a daily basis?
Kokoshaki.
Wine.
I like the way you roll.
I have found that most of what people think lead to a long, healthy life is misguided or just plain wrong. What if we could reverse engineer longevity? I spent the last 20 years trying to do just that.
Is it okay if I...
Instead of looking for answers in test tubes, I found 5 places around the world called Blue Zones where people are living to 100 at the highest rates in the world. What is the secret to living a long time?
Community. If you're depressed, you're not going to live very long.
So the steepness for us is very important. Just by walking, you have an additional energy expenditure.
Do we want to be dormant or do we want to serve humanity?
These people live to 100 at the highest rates in the world. And these secrets could help every one of us to get every good year we can get out of this body of ours. That is the promise of Blue Zones.
Amazing. It looks so great. So without further ado, let's get Dan up here. Come on up, Dan. Thank you.
What a thrill. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of this old topia. I'm ready for some new topia. I'm sorry. I'm going to talk about the world's longest lived people and the lessons they offer us. And I think you're going to find a lot of surprises. I think what most people think drives longevity is misguided and often wrong. And I hope to set the record straight. But I want to start with you guys. I'm a big believer that if you can't manage it, if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. So I'm going to start by calculating how long each and every one of you is going to live. And in order to do that, I need to ask you 8 questions. And your job is to raise your hand when the question pertains to you. And then the hard part is remember how many times you raised your hand. So you ready? All right, they start easy and they get hard. First question, raise your hand if you sleep at least 7 hours most nights. 7 hours, there we go. Well, last night doesn't count, by the way. Raise your hand if you move at least 45 minutes a day, and it can be in a gym, it can be in a garden, or it could just be walking back and forth to work. Impactful Vegan's got his hand up over there, all right? Raise your hand if you eat at least 5 servings of fruit, vegetables, or beans a day. They can be any combination, but at least 5 a day. All right, a little bit fewer, about 50% of you. Raise your hand if you have not had protected sex with a stranger. I said not. Wow, I'm going to stay up with you guys tonight. Raise your hand if you believe you're of normal weight. You believe if you're of normal weight. All right, over half of you. Raise your hand if you belong to a faith. It can be Christian, Muslim, Jewish, doesn't matter. You belong to a faith. All right, about half. Raise your hand if you've not smoked in the last 8 years. Not smoked There we go. And we're in Colorado. I mean tobacco, of course. And finally, raise your hand if you have at least three friends that meet the following criteria. Number one, you can have a meaningful conversation with them. Number two, you can call them on a bad day and they'll care. And number three, you actually like them. At least three, there we go. All right, so I asked seven questions here. If you raised your hand at least twice and you're a man, life expectancy is 72. And if you're a woman, it's 76. If you raise your hand at least five times and you're a man, your life expectancy is 83. If you're a woman, it's 87. If you raise your hand at least six times and you're a man, your life expectancy is 88. And if you're a woman, it's 92. Did anybody raise their hand all seven times? Anybody raise their hand all seven times? One right here, right? We have two right. Could you stand up, please, ma'am? Come on. Don't worry, I won't humiliate you. Too bad. Can we give her a huge Newtopia round of applause? We have martinis waiting for you outside. So, you know, when it comes to being overweight and unhealthy in this country, I believe it's not individual people's fault. And I'm going to tell you why. Something called the Danish Twin Study established that only about 20% of how long you live is dictated by your genes. The other 80% is something else. So working with National Geographic and a grant from the National Institutes on Aging, about 20 years ago, I first set off with this idea of reverse engineering longevity. So I worked with demographers. We spent about 3 years identifying five areas around the world where people are living statistically longest. They either have the highest concentration of centenarians or the lowest rate of middle-aged mortality. And we spent a long time confirming people's age. We're very careful about that before National Geographic would greenlight the story. So these are people who've achieved the outcomes we want. They're making it till their mid-90s, and they're avoiding cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, dementia, most forms of dementia, and lots of forms of cancer. And then they tend to die very quickly and leave a lot left over for their heirs. How exactly do they do it? Well, I recruited a team of experts who helped us use scientific methodology, mostly correlation, to find the common denominators in all five of these blue zones. And then once we saw the trends, then we went and underpinned them with the available academic research. We found the first blue zone about 125 miles off the coast of Italy on the island of Sardinia, not the entire island though, just a cluster of five villages, about 70,000 people in the highlands of Sardinia. There you can see the actual blue zone, and in that blue bullseye there, we have an area where there are about 15 times more male centenarians than you would expect to see in a similar population here in the United States. And middle-aged people, people my age, can expect 10 more good years. And remember, they have an average set of genes. All five of these blue zones are melting pots, genetic melting pots. So they have no genetic advantage over every one of us sitting in this audience today. So once we find the longevity, then we look at some of the factors that seem to be driving it. And this is a place where people are making it to 100, still riding their bicycle, beating a guy 65 years younger than him in an arm wrestle, and quite honestly, starting their day with a glass of wine every once in a while. Not something I would necessarily recommend, but this guy's 106, and at that age, he can have whatever he wants for breakfast, as far as I'm concerned. But to find out what a 100-year-old did for most of their life, we interviewed about 250 centenarians and gave them a survey and then tried to find what most correlate it with making 100. And we found three big things in Sardinia, and I'm going to tell them to you in reverse order. The third biggest predictor of being 100 in Sardinia is living in a steep village. The steeper their village, the better chance they had of making it to age 100. The second biggest predictor was how many daughters they had. And it turns out the guys with five or more daughters had the best chance of reaching age 100. Now, we don't know if that's because daughters tend to take better care of their aging parents, or if it's because if you can survive five adolescent girls making it to 100 is no problem. But nevertheless, there seems to be something magical about daughters. But the biggest predictor in Sardinia was actually your profession. And the farmers weren't living any longer than their Italian counterparts on the mainland. The people living a long time were the shepherds. So we embedded with the shepherds to see how their lives unfold. And it turns out these guys wake up late. They spend a few hours with their animals. They pasture them, follow their animals around for 4 or 5 kilometers in the morning. They have lunch. They take a nap, 4 or 5 more kilometers in the afternoon. And by mid-afternoon, they're back in their village having a glass of wine with their friends. Remember, these are the longest-lived men on the planet. They're not doing CrossFit. They're not doing yoga. They're not eating superfoods. What they are eating, though, is mostly the foods that they can find that they grow around them. They have a type of unleavened bread made from durum wheat called carta de musica, which they could take on their journeys as they pastured their animals for sometimes weeks at a time. They did eat some cheese from their own animals, a grass-fed sheep cheese called pecorino, very high in omega-3 fatty acids, and a type of wine that grows at altitude, turns very red. Turns out that most of the polyphenols in a red wine is found in the pigment. And this wine is so red, they call it vino nero, or black wine. It's almost always made at home. Nothing like dirty boots to add terroir. And it's consumed with meals and with friends. We calculate they have between 2 or 3 glasses of this wine per day. Don't slug it down by itself. It's all organic, low alcohol. But it's definitely part of their diet. But mostly they're eating the plants that grow around them. They have 3 growing seasons a year, and they're eating a version of the Mediterranean diet, similar to the diets around the rest of the Mediterranean, but different in a few ways. Number one, a lot more beans, a lot more fava beans, a lot more greens. They do eat meat. They're not vegans, but they eat a lot less meat than we do. They traditionally ate meat about 5 times per month. It's usually a celebratory food after church on Sunday or during a wedding. But meat was not a daily event for these people, a little over once a week. But more important than their diet, and I know we like to focus on diet, on getting healthy, but it seems the sum of a number of other things had a bigger impact on their longevity. Number one, they put family first. These guys are making it to 100. It's never because they're working out or they don't have a priority of becoming financially free or following their favorite sport. They work for their family. Older people are celebrated. Unlike America, where about 50% of our older people are warehoused in retirement homes, a Sardinian family would never do that. Older people are regarded as treasures. They're kept in the home where they receive care, but more importantly, they contribute. It's the older people that contribute the agricultural wisdom and the culinary wisdom. It's always the women that possess the culinary or the food tradition, and they pass it down. The best manifestation for me was their bread. Now, I think most people, when you talk about bread, they think about a carb, and that's going to make me fat. But the type of bread made in Sardinia is a slow-rise sourdough bread that's leavened not with yeast, but with lactobacillus. the process of which metabolizes almost all of the gluten. So it's very low gluten. And eating a piece of this bread actually lowers the glycemic load of the entire meal. And they have this bread with every meal, and they eat it every single day for years, months, or a lifetime. And it's the grandmas that keep the starter dough alive, that bacteria alive, and they keep the recipe alive. So it was a very clear manifestation of something that's been observed in cultures all over the world called the grandmother effect. And it showed that families that keep their grandmothers actually living with them or at least nearby, the children in those families have lower rates of disease, lower rates of mortality, and do better in school. So it's this beautiful virtuous circle. When children are surviving better, that adds to the life expectancy, and older people benefit as well. On the other side of the planet, Okinawa, Japan, about 800 miles south of Tokyo, we found the world's longest-lived women. In a cohort of women 60 or older, you can expect about 30 times more centenarians than you could in the United States. How did they do it? Well, diet's definitely part of it. The number one food in Okinawa, 70% of their caloric intake until about 1985 or so came from one food and one food alone. Anybody want to guess what it is? Somebody's watching that documentary. Yeah. Sweet potato. Purple sweet potato. Why? Is it because they think I'm going to eat that purple sweet potato and live to 100? No. It's because sweet potatoes don't get wiped out by typhoons like all the other crops. They're shelf-stable, they're easy to cook, and they're delicious. And that's what they learned to eat, and they learned how to make several delicious recipes. They also eat a lot of tofu, about eight times more tofu than Americans do. They have a very special, very thick tofu that they can make taste like meat. So this is their meat substitute. This is another culture. They were 98% whole food, plant-based until about the year 2000. So when they thought of meat, it was usually this. They did eat some pork, but again, pork was a celebratory food. Once again, more important than what they ate, their social constructs. I asked you that question, do you have three friends you can count on a bad day? That's the question that the National Institutes on Aging uses to assess loneliness. If you're lonely in this country, if you don't have at least three friends, it shaves about 8 years off your life expectancy. It's about as bad for you as a smoking habit. And we live in a culture where there's no guarantee we're going to have friends that look after us, who care about us. But in Okinawa, when you're 5 years old, your parents put you into a sort of circle of friends they call a moai, M-O-A-I, and you're expected to travel through life with those kids. Things go well, you know, get a raise or you win the lottery, good harvest, you're expected to share it. Conversely, if a parent gets sick, or you get divorced, or a child has a problem, you always have four or five friends that have your back. The reason I'm showing this picture here, these three friends have belonged to the same moai for 97 years. Their average age is 102. They still get together every day, gossip, drink sake, argue about who that hot guy liked best back in 1941. But they're checking in on each other constantly. They have both the very real social network and the psychological social network in they are not alone in this world. Okinawans also have a very powerful word they call ikigai. There's no word in the Okinawan vocabulary for retirement. None of this artificial punctuation between your useful life and your life of repose. And by the way, the year you retire, you have a huge spike in mortality. Your chances are dying the year you retire is greater than any other year of your adult life. There's something very dangerous about retirement. In Okinawa, instead of retire, they continue to contribute, whether it's teaching karate, whether it's fishing and distributing the fish to your family, or whether it's just being the spiritual leader of their village. Kamada-san here her daytime job is looking after the spiritual health of her village, but her ikigai was actually her great-great-great-granddaughter. These two girls are separated in age by 101.5 years, and when I asked her what it feels like to hold a descendant more than a century younger than her, she said, it feels like leaping into heaven. Kind of makes you look forward to getting old. So my editor at National Geographic told me I needed to find America's blue zone. And we spent a lot of time actually in the prairies of Minnesota, where I'm from originally. A place called La Caparo has the highest concentration of centenarians in America. But when you peel back the oven, you find that it's mostly because all the young people had left these small towns for Minneapolis, and you have an artificially high concentration of old people, therefore an artificially high concentration of the oldest old. America's Blue Zone we found in a very unusual place, 70 miles southeast of Los Angeles, California, down the San Bernardino Freeway. You get off at the Loma Linda exit, and the first thing you see is a Del Taco and a Wiener Hut. And it's like, what? This is a Blue Zone? Well, if you go back a little farther, you find the highest concentration of Seventh-day Adventists in the world. Seventh-day Adventists are conservative Methodists who distinguish themselves from other Christians in that, number one, they evangelize with health, and number two, they celebrate their Sabbath on the seventh day, which is Saturday instead of Sunday. So it makes them a little bit of a cultural outcast for a few reasons. But they have long asserted they're healthier than the rest of Americans, and the National Institutes on Health actually funded something called the Adventist Health Study, which followed 103,000 Americans for 30 years. And it found that the average woman in America, life expectancy is 80, but for Adventist women, they're living about 9 years longer, and for the men, the difference is even more remarkable. Adventist men are living about 11 years longer than their North American counterpart. This is not hearsay. This is not Dan Buettner going and finding some 100-year-olds and reporting a blue zone. This is gold standard epidemiology. So you have a decade, you have an entire population living about a decade longer than the rest of us. Is it because they have better genes? No. If you look at an Adventist congregation, you see people of European extraction, you see African Americans, you see Asians, you see Latin Americans. It's a melting pot. But they do a few things differently. First of all, they take this Sabbath very seriously. From sunset on Friday night until sunset on Saturday night, no matter how busy they are, no matter what work is telling them to do, no matter where the kids need to be driven, no matter what the social schedule is dictating, they stop everything. And for 24 hours, they focus on their God, they focus on their family, and they focus on their social network, and they take a nature walk. Saturday morning is for their religious service. Saturday afternoon are potluck lunches. Hardwired right in their religion, Saturday afternoon is a nature walk. Something they do not just for a few weeks or years, but every single Sunday for a lifetime. The definition of nature walk has evolved. And then they take their diet directly from the Bible. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27 actually lays out the diet of the Garden of Eden. And it's a very good diet. One stanza says, every plant that bears seed, so that's nuts and grains and beans and pulses. Every tree that bears fruit, so that's, you know, citrus and apples and avocados and tomatoes. And then one stanza later, God talks about green plants. And the Adventists just take that very seriously. So if you open an Adventist refrigerator, it looks like this. There's no sweetened yogurts in there. There's no bologna. There's no hot dogs. They're all things that are going to add to your life expectancy. I met a 93-year-old Ellsworth Wareham early on in my research, a multimillionaire. And I asked him, well, he was about to build a privacy fence around his yard, and he got a bid from a contractor, and the contractor wanted $6,000. And he said, well, for that kind of money, I'll do it myself. And for the next 3 days, we followed him around as he shoveled cement and hauled timbers. And on the fourth day, he ended up in the operating room. But this is not Ellsworth Wareham getting open heart surgery. This is Ellsworth Wareham doing open heart surgery, which he continued to do until age 100. Ed Rawlings, another good Adventist, 106 years old, working cowboy, starts his day with a swim, and on the weekends, he puts on the skis. And then my favorite, Marge Jaton. Marge wakes up every morning, pumps iron, eats her oatmeal, steel-cut oatmeal. She's very prescriptive about it, with dates, nuts, topped with oat milk, followed by what she called a prune juice shooter. Think about that, moving right on through. And then she get on her stationary bike, ride her bike for an hour, get in her Cadillac, and drive around Loma Linda, where she served for 7 different organizations as a volunteer. She worked for her church. She went to the Loma Linda Senior Center, where she went and helped out the old folks every Tuesday and Thursday. She was a woman whose motto was, a stranger is a friend I haven't met yet. I asked her at one point, I drove around with her in her Cadillac for 2 days. And at one point I looked over and I said, what does the body feel like when you're 105 years old? And she looked back over at me with kind of a side glance and she said, well, I feel a lot sexier than I do now than I did at 104. But this kind of emblemized the attitude. You know, all the blue zones I visited, I never met a grump in the bunch. And it turns out that grumpy people actually die sooner, apparently because they don't get as good a health care. But I wrote up these three stories, these three cultures for National Geographic. It's one of the best-selling issues in their history. I wrote 3 more books called Blue Zones, different Blue Zone books. 4 of them, well, I've written 4 New York Times bestsellers to date, but the first 3 were bestsellers. I'm going to tell you about the 4th one. You know, I never made money until I was 39 years old. I never made more than $18,000 a year. I was an explorer. And all of a sudden, I got this blockbuster book, and I got money. And like a good explorer, I immediately took that money and went out to look for more blue zones. So I gathered this team of scientists, Michelle Poulon with the white hair and Luis Rosero Bixby with the dark hair in the middle there. These are world-class demographers, and we spent 5 more years looking for more blue zones. It's a big job. You have to parse through worldwide population data, and you have to confirm ages, and you dig a lot of dry wells. But we hit longevity gold in a place called the Nicoya Peninsula of Costa Rica. Amazing place. This place has the lowest rate of middle-aged mortality in the world. What does that mean? That means that people our age have the best chance of reaching a healthy age 95, about a 3-fold better chance of reaching a healthy age 95 than Americans do. And you say to yourself, well, how do they do it? I mean, they're poor. They spend 1/15 the amount we do on healthcare. And somehow they're eluding diabetes and heart disease and several kinds of cancer. So you look for clues. And one of their clues we discovered, about 80% of their dietary intake came from 3 foods. Most of you can probably guess, this is Latin America, but it's the 3 sisters. Corn, whole grain corn, not GMO, which they ground into beautiful whole grain tortillas. They added squash to that and beans. And when you combine these 3 foods together, you not only get niacin, micronutrients, lots of fiber, complex carbohydrates, but you also get protein, all the amino acids. You bring these 3 foods together into 2 bean tacos and you have more protein than you do in a quarter pounder from McDonald's. And it's a heck of a lot healthier. This is 80% of what they're eating on a day-to-day basis. So there are several other factors, but this is producing the longest lived people in the Western Hemisphere, and we ought to be paying attention to what they're doing because they're, again, achieving the outcomes we want. And finally, the last blue zone, the island of Ikaria, Greece, off the coast of Turkey. Extraordinary place. They live about 8 years longer than Americans, and no discernible dementia. We found about 98% of everybody over 65. We gave them the same cognitive test that the National Institutes on Aging uses to assess for dementia. We found only 2 mild cases of dementia. So this is an island where people are living a long time and staying sharp until the end. By the way, if you live in America and you make it to age 85, there's a 50% chance you're suffering from dementia. Here, it's effectively zero. How are they doing it? Well, Ikaria was an isolated island, no natural ports. So they didn't have any of the influences from Western civilization. And they incubated their own diet and their own way of life. They're very tough, rugged people who once again grew most of their own food. They developed the purest form of the Mediterranean diet in the world. There's actually an international organization that measures qualities of Mediterranean diets. This is the purest form. You know, lots of the same things. We have fruits and vegetables and nuts and a little bit of fish and a little bit of wine. But a couple interesting things. About 80 different varieties of greens. The type of shit we'd weed whack from our backyard, these old ladies are all gathering off the side of the road, which they use to make beautiful salads. They bake them in pies. And many of these greens have 10 times the antioxidants that red wine does. So that might be one of them. But the other more convincing ingredient are these herbs. You have from the left an endemic oregano, a rosemary, a sage, and a catnip. We had these herbs sent to the University of Athens and analyzed. They were all very high antioxidant, high anti-inflammatory. Inflammation, by the way, is at the root of every age-related disease. And many of them were also mild or medium diuretics, which lower your blood pressure. So the Ikarians use these in their food. They use them as medicines. But mostly, because they were too poor for coffee, they use them as their warm beverage every single day. So the reason these things are possibly contributing to their extra 8 years and no dementia is because for a lifetime, they're chronically lowering their blood pressure, they're chronically lowering their inflammation, and they're chronically lowering their oxidation load. So I don't know for sure. All I know is a lot of herbs, they live a long time. Like other blue zones, older people are honored. They don't really retire. This 103-year-old priest continued to tend to his flock on an ATV. Another scary adventure. I'd like to tell the story of this little fellow right here on the right. His name is Stamatis moraitis. At age 21, he comes to America. Wants to pursue the American dream. He gets a job as a painter. Very hardworking Greek. Gets lots of work, makes money, marries a Greek-American woman, buys a house in the suburb, buys a Chevrolet. But at age 66, he feels himself short of breath. He goes to 3 doctors, all of whom tell him, you have terminal lung cancer, 6 months to live, better get your affairs in order. Well, instead of dying in Detroit, he figures, I'm going back to Korea. I'm going to get buried with my ancestors overlooking the Aegean Sea. Not only that, my funeral will be about 1/10 as expensive. My wife will have more left over. So he moves back to Korea and moves in with his mom and dad, who are in perfect shape. Starts eating this Korean diet, drinking the wine, drinking these teas. He reconnects with the religion, reconnects with his friends. 6 months come and go, and he's feeling pretty good. And he gets up one morning and he goes out in his backyard. You remember, he's supposed to be dead. Goes in the backyard, plants a vineyard. And he thinks to himself, well, I'm not going to be here to harvest these grapes, but my wife will.
And when my wife picks these grapes, she'll think of me and remember me. Well, to make a long story medium, 34 years later when I met him at age 100, he was picking all those grapes himself, making 200 liters of wine a year, all of which he drank. Amazing guy. And of course, as a journalist, you know, I met him, interviewed him, and I wanted to know his secret. And I was pretty sure it wasn't his ability to match plaids. And this guy speaks perfect English, and how do you explain it? He goes, I don't know. I guess I just forgot to die. Which sounds flippant and pedestrian, but that answer was closest to the real answer of any of the 105 experts, a nutritionist and cellular and longevity, all these experts. He was closer to the right answer than anybody else. Why? Because in none of these blue zones, these people who are staying fit and sharp and do the 100, in none of them are people saying to themselves at age 50, well, God darn it, I'm going to get on that longevity diet and live another 50 years. None of them do CrossFit. None of them do triathlons. None of them are eating superfoods or running down to Costa Rica for stem cell transplants. In fact, they have no idea why they're living a long time. They just are. And the big insight here, and this is way different than the way we think of health. The way we think of health in America is we got to find the right diet and the right exercise program and the right regimen and muster the discipline and the presence of mind and stay on it. In blue zones, health and longevity are not pursued. They ensue. They ensue from the right environment. No matter where you go in the world and you see manifestly long-lived people, not Instagram longevity people, but real populations, they're not exercising. In fact, I would argue exercise has been an unmitigated public health failure. The average American, well, there's only about 24% of Americans who get only 20 minutes of physical activity a day. Three quarters don't even get that. But in blue zones, they're getting about 8,000 steps a day because every time they go to work or a friend's house or their kids go to school, it occasions a walk. They have gardens out back, three growing seasons a year, so they're moving naturally in their gardens. Another few hundred calories a day burned. Their houses aren't full of mechanical convenience to do their housework or to knead bread or to mix things. Everything's done by hand. My team calculates they're nudged into movement every 20 minutes or so without thinking about it. They suffer the same stresses that we suffer. They worry about their kids. They worry about their health. They worry about their finances. In fact, in all these blue zones, they're below the U.S. poverty level in income. But what they have that we've forgotten are these sacred daily rituals that our grandmothers knew. They eat dinner as a family. The Okinawans take some time every day to remember their ancestors, remember where they came from. The Icarians and Costa Ricans take a nap, which actually lowers your chance of heart disease by about 30%. And the Sardinians, well, they just do happy hour, which is the practice I picked up. They have vocabulary for purpose. People think purpose, that sounds kind of airy-fairy to me. But actually, the director of the National Institute on Aging, Robert Butler, did a study that examined the writings of people and followed them over 20 years and found that people who could articulate their sense of purpose live about 8 years longer than people who are rudderless. Show me any supplement that can give you another 8 years of life expectancy. And there is a mountain of good research underpinning the power of waking up with a sense of purpose. What they consume, most of them drink, even about half of the Adventists. And I'm very aware that the current epidemiology or the current states of science warns us away from drinking. But I can tell you, in the Mediterranean blue zones, about 90% of people who are making it into their 90s or 100s are drinking a little bit every day. Maybe they can make it to 102, but they find wine part of the human experience, bringing people together, enjoying their food more. Their diet, whole food, plant-based, but I'm going to unpack that with some detail in a minute here. We have this attitude, and I know it's a useful marketing attitude, to add things. Well, we need more omega-3 fatty acids. We need more protein. We need more minerals. But the general characteristic of the Blue Zone diet is taking out things. They have strategies to keep from overeating. They eat breakfast like a king, lunch like a prince, and dinner like a pauper, no dinner at all. And then they leave their digestive systems about 14 hours to rest. They eat dinner as a family, which actually occasions consuming fewer calories. They tend to eat smaller portions or fill their plates with smaller portions and put their leftovers away rather than putting them on the table where they're eaten during the dinner instead. But the foundation of all these Blue Zones, and this is probably 50% of the answer, is they keep their aging parents nearby, they invest in their partners, and they invest in their children. The moment you put your aging parent in a retirement home, they lose between 2 and 6 years of life expectancy. The moment you end up on your own, either through divorce or through spouse dying, or you just decide to be single, that shaves between 2 and 5 years off your life expectancy. And investing in your kids is a good idea because then they're less likely to put you in a retirement home. They tend to belong to a faith. We don't know why, and I'm not particularly religious myself, but people who go to church, temple, or mosque and show up 4 times per month live 4 to 14 years longer than people who don't. We don't know exactly why, but it's arguably the most cost-effective public health intervention ever invented. And then finally, and this is probably the most actionable for most of us, they are very careful about who they let into their lives. We now know that if your 3 best friends are obese and unhealthy, your chances of being overweight yourself go up by 150%. Abusive drinking is contagious. Drug use is contagious. Unhappiness is contagious. Even loneliness is contagious. In Blue Zones, the people they surround themselves with tend to perpetuate healthy behaviors. And the takeaway for most of us is, while I wouldn't necessarily tell you to dump your old unhealthy friends, I will tell you that to be proactive about bringing a few friends into your immediate social circle whose idea of recreation is golf or pickleball or riding a bike, people who care about you on a bad day. And it's not a bad idea to have a vegetarian or a vegan. There's a great vegan right there, the Impactful Vegan. Raise your hand so everybody can meet you afterwards. One of the great, one of my great heroes right here, who will teach you how and where to find and eat healthy, whole food, plant-based. So people look at this pyramid and say, that sounds like common sense to me. But it's not common sense. It's nowhere near common sense in the United States. In America, when we think about staying healthy, we only spend about 4% of our $4.4 trillion healthcare bill on prevention. And most of that's on diets, supplements, and exercise programs. And I'm not here to badmouth any of them, but I can tell you we spend a lot of money on them, and they don't last for very long. Even, let's just pretend the Blue Zone diet is the best diet in the world, which I think it is. If I got 100% of you on that diet today, I would lose 10% of you in just 3 months. I'd lose 90% of you in 7 months. We're hardwired for novelty, our brains are. And I'd lose almost all of you in 2 years. If your financial planner showed you this return curve, you would fire him. But every year in January, 80 million Americans say, I'm going to get on that diet and lose weight this year. Same thing happens. Same thing with exercise programs. We start with a lot of zeal. They fail for about 80% of people after a year. And even if I come home from the Blue Zones with the pill guaranteed to reverse aging, most Americans wouldn't take it long enough to make a difference. So if that doesn't work, what does? We have five beautiful templates in Blue Zones. These are people who are manifestly living longer, and they're enjoying the journey. What are they doing? They're eating mostly a whole food, plant-based diet. They're moving naturally, unconsciously, about 20 minutes a day. Their life is underpinned with purpose. They curate their immediate social circle, and they live in places in general where the healthy choice is the easy choice. And the secret to longevity doesn't lie in any one of these circles. Marketers like to pull out one element and sell it to you, but it's the interconnected, mutually supporting nature of all five of these things that keep people doing the right thing and avoiding the wrong thing for long enough so they don't develop an avoidable chronic disease, period. This is what works. And my day job for the last 15 years, I've been hired by insurance companies throughout America, and I've worked with 72 cities. We're measured by Gallup, and in every one of those cities, I've been able to raise the life expectancy, lower healthcare costs, and it's been a fantastically successful approach. But nonetheless, you show people this, and it's foreign, you know, it's a mouthful to explain. And at a certain point, I realize that for most people, the runway to changing their health is through their mouth. And that's where you guys come in. That's through their mouth. So we have a big problem in this country. Do you know, this is according to the CDC, 670,000 Americans die every single year eating the standard American diet. We lose more Americans eating American than we do in American wars, since the Civil War, by the way. Why? First of all, we live in an environment where about 60% of all foods is ultra-processed. We mindlessly consume about 120 pounds of sugar every year. We eat about 400 pounds of dairy, about 220 pounds of meat. That's a bathtub of dead animal. I'm not saying a little meat's not fine, but that's just too much. And we're bamboozled by diets. They're relentlessly marketed to us. The vegan diet, the keto diet, the Whole 30 diet, the Ornish diet, the paleo, the Atkins, the South Beach. What are you supposed to do? Well, I knew I had populations who were living a long time, and I knew their diet was an important component of it. So for about 3 years, I worked with Harvard University to create something called a meta-analysis. So if you want to know what a centenarian ate to live to be 100, you have to know what they ate as a little girl and middle age and lately. You can't just ask them what they've been eating, because people don't remember. If I asked you what you had for lunch a week ago Tuesday, you probably couldn't tell me. So how are you going to ask a 100-year-old what they were eating when they were 12? So to get at that, we found dietary studies, 155 of them, that have been done in all five blue zones over the past 100 years. And this meta-analysis is a process of, for more or less, averaging them out. And you get a very clear signal of what people actually ate who turn out to live to be 100. And here it is. This slide took me 8 years. They're eating mostly a whole food, plant-based diet. And get this, mostly carbohydrates. It's a high-carb diet. But remember, both jelly beans and lentil beans are carbs. We're talking the lentil bean end of things. So the five pillars of every longevity diet in the world are whole grains, greens and garden vegetables, tubers like that sweet potato, nuts, a handful of nuts a day is equivalent to about 2 extra years of life expectancy. And the cornerstone of every longevity diet in the world, dun-da-da-da, beans. People eat a cup of beans a day, on average can expect 4 extra years of life expectancy. They do eat meat, a lot less than we think, a lot less fish than we might think. No cow's dairy in any of the blue zone. You see a little sheep's milk cheese or goat's milk cheese. And then when it comes to what they drink, 6 glasses of water, teas of all kinds, both black and green and herbal, good news for most of us, coffee seems to be one of the indulgences we can enjoy with impunity, and then wine. And, well, that's what people ate. So now I know what people ate, and then to bring it to life so that people would actually eat it, I teamed up with my National Geographic photographer. That's David McLean. He and I have been working for National Geographic for 20 years. He's done 6 cover stories. We went back to all the blue zones. So remember, we know what the ingredients are, and then we just went and found old ladies who cook this way. Remember, it's the ladies who are the keepers of the food tradition. And I sat and take meticulous notes on what they ate, and then I sent it to a company in Los Angeles who could help translate handfuls and pinches into cups and tablespoons, and got my an 85-year-old father who grew up on a farm to help taste every one of the recipes. By the way, you guys are marketers. You can try to sell food on, it's healthy for you. You can try to sell it on, it's good for the environment. You can try to sell it, it's good for animals. But at the end of the day, what most people really care about is my lunch delicious? Or is my dinner delicious? And if it ain't delicious, people don't care as much. So I meticulously went through 500 recipes to find what I call maniacally delicious foods, and put them in my book, The Blue Zone Kitchen, which is now one of the best-selling books of all time, cookbooks of all time. It's outsold my other, I like to think I'm a science journalist, but I'm most known for writing a cookbook. But anyway, I'm very proud of it. But the natural extension of that is I teamed up a year ago with a fantastic team. Abby's here, and Scott Marcus, and Matthew O'Hare, who know the grocery business, and they agreed with my idea of creating foods formulated for longevity with a maniacal focus on deliciousness. And we created a series of, now we have 8 meals, both dinners. They're all 100% whole food, plant-based, ingredients from the long blue zones, and maniacally delicious. Now we have some breakfasts, and right now they're the top 3 bestsellers in the plant-based frozen food area. They're in all Whole Foods. People Magazine gave us an award. And it goes to show, I believe, and this is a message for all, if you have an original story, a story rooted in true health or true climate or making the world a better place, and you focus on deliciousness, which I've walked the hall here. You guys have nailed it in many ways. America will buy it. And if you want to know more about it, we're at, what booth are we at, Abby? 1508 in the Thrive neighborhood. I'll be over there if you have any more questions. But now I want to bring up the moderator here. I have 8 more minutes to answer your questions. And thank you for being such good listeners. And by the way, thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Great stuff. Such good stuff. It's interesting. I kind of find it inspiring and overwhelming at the same time. Who doesn't want to live that life? And then I feel like, oh my God, where do I start? How do I do that? Any thought?
All right. Well, I start with food. I'm a big believer, even though I sell frozen foods, I'd rather see Americans cook at home. Every time you go out to eat, you consume about 300 more calories. And those calories tend to be laden with sodium and sugar than if you just cook at home. And I think the very first step is teaching Americans how to cook meals that they love. Start with an Instapot and cook at home. And honestly, if I could get people to do that, I'd be even happier than selling frozen foods.
Yeah, see, I want the answer to be just drink more wine, but I guess I'm probably not alone with that. But so then let's bring it to the industry, and I appreciate how you brought it to the industry with your brand, Blue Zones Kitchen. And there's a similar challenge there, right? You can make these wonderful recipes, and you can sell them in the freezer section, right? And yet there's no community in that package. There's no spirituality, there's no God in that package. There's no walking uphill in that package. How do you How do you do that? How do you, is there
you
a
You have
way
to open the freezer door.
No,
you ask a very good question. So, like I said, I think of it as the tip of the spear. You know, I'm not a grocer. I don't know how to market food. But it's my way of introducing people into this bigger Blue Zones ethos. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to, and like I said, food is the runway, I think, for a different way of thinking about health.
Yeah. And I think it's a similar, in fact, let's get some questions here. Let's see some hands from the audience, and we have some mic runners. But yeah, I think it's a similar thing. Everyone here who has a brand, I was going to ask for a show of hands, but that would be confusing. But there's a mission behind the brand, and it's hard to package that mission. So I just think it's really an interesting place to focus.
I was wondering how community plays into Blue Zones. I know that's a big thing that I've heard from studying you and reading some of your books, and very curious on your take on that.
Community is one of the four pillars of Blue Zones. It's whole food, plant-based, it's moving naturally, it's having a community, and that's having and living your purpose. I would say you could sum it up with that. So when you say community, there's two types of community in my mind. There's the community that you create around you, which is pretty easy to curate. And then the second one is the neighborhood you choose to live in. I'm actually writing another book on health-adjusted life expectancy right now and finding that our neighborhood is the neighborhoods that we choose to live in is probably the biggest single driver of your health and or lack thereof. And in Minneapolis, for example, we have a neighborhood called Seward where people enjoy 13 extra years of life expectancy than Frogtown, which is just 3 miles down the road. And you look at Seward, and they have a healthy co-op. By the way, they're mostly immigrants in both of them. It's not because there's, you know, a different ethnic makeup, but there are sidewalks connecting people. The streets are walkable. They've made an effort in the neighborhood to clean up spray paint, which makes people feel more safe. There's an arborist who plants trees. There's a good bus system. So, you know, the average American loses about 15 years of life expectancy by choosing to live in America over, for example, certain places in Italy that we found. The biggest thing we can do if we want to live longer is choose another neighborhood. And some of the best neighborhoods in America to live or the best communities are Boulder, Colorado, San Luis Obispo in California. Both of those cities should give you an extra 5 to 8 years of life expectancy.
Dan, when we talked on the phone last week, you also mentioned the word gratitude, approaching the food we eat with gratitude. Could you say a bit about that?
So in all these Blue Zones, they take a minute before they eat, and they express some thanks for their food. It's Harajachi Boo in Costa Rica, I'm sorry, in Okinawa. The Adventists will always say grace. And, you know, who knows? If there's a God, you know, maybe if you pray to God, God bestows health. But a better explanation for me is we all live busy lives. And if we roll right from our cortisone-infused, stressful life right to the dinner table, we know if a lot of cortisone rolling through your brain, it interrupts your digestion. But more importantly, if we're eating fast, there's almost no chance that the full belly feeling reaches in our brain in time for our brain to tell us to stop eating. It takes about 20 minutes for that feeling, that full feeling, to travel from our belly to our brain. So expressing some gratitude, slowing down. Thank you for this food. Thank you for the people around me. Let's have a conversation. Eat slowly. Yeah, so that's the Dan Buettner take on.
Yeah, good. Let's go to this question here. Keep talking, it'll catch up.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much for the presentation, it was great. I want just to go back to the meta-analysis you did on the diet to identify the specific element in the food that could contribute to longevity, including beans, nuts, and greens. Is there any specific compounds or active ingredients in those foods that you believe could contribute to the longevity?
I'm glad. So you guys heard the question. I'm glad you asked about nutrients. And there may be. There may be. But I think nutrients further confuse people. A lot of Americans go out and take supplements and they think, well, I've taken my vitamins for today, I'll have a happy meal for lunch. It doesn't work that way. And you know, the pool of people who take supplements actually suffer higher rates of mortality than the pool of people who don't take supplements. So trying to identify the individual nutrient, I think it's just confusing. Eat whole food, plant-based, and you're 95% the way there. There are some people who are vitamin D deficient because they live in the winter in the north, or if you're a vegan, you need to supplement with vitamin B12. But if you're eating whole food, plant-based, you don't need to try to confuse people with, and I know the moment I say a nutrient, some vitamin maker is going to pick it up and there's going to be some damn Blue Zone supplement I got to whack-a-mole away. So I don't believe in supplements.
And then at Nutrition Business Journal, we'll tell you exactly how much that is selling in the market and what an opportunity it is. Yeah, let's take one more question.
Do you see any correlation of pets and animals in any of the communities you've studied?
Between what?
Pets and ownership of pets and their influence?
You know, they don't really have pets. If you have a dog, the dog's pretty much put to work. And I think it would appall most pet owners how dogs live there. But that's the way dogs have always lived. Dogs are often help shepherds corral. And, you know, I'm very well embedded in the vegan environment, and I know this animal cruelty is a real big issue in this country. But there's sort of a Faustian bargain that goes on. Humans are protecting these animals, making sure they're fed. They have an okay life. They're protected from predators. But there comes a day when, you know, they might have 4 or 5 good years and then a really bad day. And in most of the Blue Zones, they could not have survived. If the Blue Zones are rugged, rocky terrain, very hard to grow food. They needed animals to aggregate enough calories to survive. We have the technology to evolve beyond that now, but it's still that way in Blue Zone. Anyway, thank you again. I'm out of time. I'm going to be back on what stage? The generative stage. What is it?
The Represent Kitchen.
Yeah.
Dan will be in the Represent Kitchen later this afternoon for one of the stage takeovers with Blue Zone Kitchen, his brand.
And then I'm going to go to booth 1506. And then if you have any questions, come see me. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I love you. I know lots of other stuff you could be doing. And I'll see you when you're 100.
Okay.